So last time we left at the lower end of the humerus. We talked about the muscles attached on the humerus scapula. Once again, let's start with the radius and ulna, and we're going to begin with the ossification of these two bones. These again being the long bones, so they're having this endochondral ossification. The shaft, guys, if you look at the shaft, even for the radius and for the ulna, we have one primary center for both. So there is a one primary center of ossification for both shaft of the radius as well as ulna, and this primary center for both these bones, it will appear in the 8th week of intrauterine life. In the 8th week of intrauterine life, we have this, the one primary center for both for radius and ulna will appear in the 8th week of intrauterine life. Now we have, for both the radius and ulna, we have two secondary centers, one for the upper end, one for the lower end. And for the upper end of the radius and ulna, let me take you back to the discussion we had last time when we talked about this one mnemonic crito. Guys, if this is the lower end of the humerus, and let's say this is the capitulum, here is the trochlea, and this is the medial epicondyle, so that's capitulum, trochlea, medial epicondyle. The radius, and let's say this is ulna, right? And if you remember, the mnemonic for the ossification center was crito. So C is for the capitulum, R is for the radial head, I is for the internal epicondyle, T is for the trochlea, O is for olecranon process, which will be more posteriorly actually, and E is for external epicondyle. So it's C-R-I-T-O-E. And these secondary center of ossification around the elbow region, they appear at the age of 1st year, 3rd year, 5th year, 7th year, 9th and 11th year. So we already discussed that last time. Today, because we are discussing the radius and ulna, so our primary focus is on the radius and ulna here. So the secondary center for the upper end of the radius and the secondary center for the upper end of the ulna, as you can see, this radius and ulna, it will be 3rd year and 9th year. It is the 3rd year and the 9th. So that's one secondary center, guys. This is one secondary center. Let me just write that secondary center. I'm just trying to write them a bit neatly so that you can take a snapshot if you want. And then we have a secondary center for the lower end also. For the lower end of both radius and ulna, the secondary center will appear. For the lower end of the radius, it appears in the 1st year itself. Actually, it's not exactly 1st year, it's somewhere between 9 to 26 months. So for 1st to 2nd year, we can say. So I'm going with 1st year. And the lower end of the ulna, the secondary center, this is again a secondary center only, will appear at the age of 6. Before I talk about the fusion of these secondary centers, these are the secondary centers, as we said, upper end of the radius ulna and lower end of the radius ulna. One thing, if you note, guys, I mean, just for the memory purpose, if imagine this is a radius bone here and here is ulna. Let's say this is radius and this is ulna. The secondary center, if you look carefully, they are coming first for this lower end of radius, then for the upper end of the radius, then for the lower end of ulna, and then for the upper end of the ulna. So if you remember this arrow like this, so you can remember that what is it, which center, secondary center appears first. So we have first for the secondary centers for the lower end of the radius comes first, then for the upper end of radius, then for lower end of ulna, and then for the upper end of the ulna. That's the time of appearance of these secondary centers. Now, what time these secondary center will fuse with the shaft? So first thing first, guys, the secondary center for the base, whether it is radius or ulna, they both will fuse by the age of 20. This one and this one, both these secondary center, they will fused by the age of 20 years. fused to their respective shaft by the age of 20 years. And if you look at the upper end here, the upper end, the secondary center of the upper end, which appears at the age of 3 and 9 respectively, they will fuse by the age of 12 and 18 years. This is 12 years for the upper end of radius and 18 years for the upper end of the ulna. So what you can see, that 12 and 18 for the upper end, for the lower end, in both the cases we have 20 years, which tells me that the growing end of the radius and ulna is the lower end. That is the one which will fuse later. So that is a growing end of the radius and ulna. I hope you heard of this dictum which says that the direction of the nutrient foramen tells you something about their growing end. Like if the direction of the nutrient foramen is downwards, then the growing end of the bone will be upwards. Now if you look carefully in these two bones, guys, if you look at this is a nutrient foramen for the radius, and this here is a nutrient foramen for the ulna, and they both are directed upwards. So the nutrient artery, when it enters, it goes to the cortical bone obliquely upwards, which tells me that the growing end is the lower end here. I'm writing GE, that is growing end of both these bone is a lower end. There's a saying for this, for the nutrient foramen. They say that to the elbow I go, from the knee I flee. To the elbow I go. These nutrient foramen are directed toward the elbow in the bones of the upper limb. For the humerus, the nutrient foramen will be downward. And for the radius and ulna, the nutrient foramen will be upward. So they're basically towards the elbow. To the elbow I go. But in the lower limb, the nutrient foramen are going away from the knee. So for tibia fibula, they're going downward. And for the femur, they're going upward. Which tells me that the direction of the growing end is the opposite to it. If to the elbow I go is the direction of nutrient foramen, so that means in the humerus, the growing end is upper end. And in radius and ulna, the growing end is the lower end, which is opposite to the direction of nutrient foramen. Okay, so this is a bit about some details about the ossification of the radius and ulna, both being a long bone, having endochondral ossification, one primary center for both, for the shaft of both the bones, one each. And then we have two secondary centers for their upper end and the lower end. Okay, now let us look at some osteological features of both these bones. And once you know these features, then we can move on to what muscles are present in the anterior and posterior compartment and the respective attachment also. So let me use this picture. It's a ventral aspect of the radius and ulna you're looking at. Some important bony prominences that you should know about. For the PGME examination, we don't have to know every single detail of the bone, but yeah, some important traction epiphyses, some processes, and some fibrocartilages, all these some important projections of the bone we should know about. Okay, now as you can see, guys, this process here, this extension, clearly it is the olecranon process. This here is the olecranon process, and look at this projection forward. This is the coronoid process. So we have an olecranon process and we have this coronoid process. And the articular surface, which is provided by this olecranon process as well as this coronoid process, together forms this notch, which is called as a trochlear notch. This here is the trochlear notch, the same trochlear notch which will provide the articulation to the trochlear part of the humerus. Remember the capitulum and trochlea, the medial one is a trochlea. So that trochlea will be articulating in this trochlear notch, which is partly formed by this olecranon and partly by this conoid process actually. Okay, this circular head, obviously it's a radial head which will be encircled by the annular ligament. So here is the radial head. And as I said, this radial head is encircled by this ligament, which is the annular ligament. You all must have read about this annular ligament in the pulled elbow. Okay. What else? Now, one important feature for both radius and ulna, you can see this tuberosity on the radius, which is facing more toward the medial side. And here's a tuberosity on the ulna, which is facing more anteriorly. And see that there's a reason behind it, guys. This tuberosity is called as the radial tuberosity. This tuberosity here is a radial tuberosity. And why this radial tuberosity is important? Because it is the major insertion for the biceps brachii muscle. So our biceps brachii muscle, that is the one which is inserted on the radial tuberosity. And what is to be noted, it is inserted not on the anterior surface but on the posterior surface of radial tuberosity. Now look at this, I'm having this left radius with me, I hope you can appreciate it. Now that's a radial tuberosity, can you see that? So when the bicep muscle comes, the tendon of the bicep muscle is not inserted on this anterior surface, it is actually turning backward and then inserting to the posterior side of this radial tuberosity. Why it is important to note this? Because the bicep is not only a flexor at the elbow, it is also a very strong supinator as well. In the mid-prone position, we know that bicep is a very strong supinator, and that is only possible because the tendon of the bicep brachii is inserted to the posterior part of the radial tuberosity, which allows this torque force to act on it, and that allows the radius to rotate and leads to the supination. Whereas this tuberosity, which is present on the ventral aspect of upper end of ulna, is the ulnar tuberosity. This here is the ulnar tuberosity. This also is important because this is the insertion for the brachialis muscle. That is an insertion for the brachialis muscle. Remember, brachialis muscle we discussed last time. It was a muscle which was originating from the anterior lateral and anterior medial surface of humerus. In the lower half of the humerus, the anterior surface is occupied by the origin of brachialis muscle. And this brachialis muscle goes straight downwards. After forming the floor of the cubital fossa, it is inserted to this, ulnar tuberosity. And that's why, because it is not inserted to medial side or lateral side, something like that. So the muscle, the only action of brachialis muscle is the flexion at the elbow. It cannot produce any torque on any of these bones. So it is only responsible for flexion. But biceps brachii is a flexor at the elbow. Because of its insertion to posterior side of radial tuberosity, it is also a strong supinator as well. Okay, what else we can appreciate in this osteology part of this radius and ulna, guys? Can you see this? Now, this obviously is the interosseous membrane. This here is the interosseous membrane. But apart from interosseous membrane, if you look carefully, there is another cord which is present here, which is called as an oblique cord. Now, this could be a question, it is asked as well. Oblique cord. First of all, what is the extension of the oblique cord? If let me enlarge it for you. The extension of oblique cord is from the medial side of this ulnar tuberosity. Lateral side, I'm sorry. It is from the lateral side of the ulnar tuberosity and it goes till the point below the radial tuberosity. From the lateral side of the ulnar tuberosity, as you can see this, and then it is reaching till the lower part of the radial tuberosity. If you look at the direction of the oblique cord, it is opposite to the interosseous membrane. Interosseous membrane is directed from radius to ulna downwards, but oblique cord is directed from ulna to radius downwards. So that is like the direction is opposite. What is this oblique cord, guys? This oblique cord is considered to be the remnant of a muscle of the forearm, which we will discuss in a while, that is flexor pollicis longus. It is a remnant of the muscle that is flexor pollicis longus. This could be a question, that oblique cord, which is extending from the ulna to radius, is a remnant of which muscle? It's a remnant of flexor pollicis longus. And what you see between the oblique cord and interosseous membrane, you can see that there's a small triangular space which is present over there. And this triangular space which is present between the oblique cord and interosseous membrane is allowing the passage of posterior interosseous artery. That's how the posterior interosseous artery will reach backward and will be running behind the interosseous membrane. And guys, please mind it, it's posterior interosseous artery, not posterior interosseous nerve. Posterior interosseous nerve will reach backward by passing between the two lamina of supinator muscle. That's a different story altogether. We will see that. Posterior interosseous nerve passes between the lamina of supinator. Posterior interosseous artery is passing between oblique cord and interosseous membrane to reach at the back of forearm. Whereas you can appreciate, if this is a posterior interosseous artery, obviously then anterior interosseous artery will be running like this. And what you will see, that anterior interosseous artery will enter, this artery here is the anterior interosseous artery, and anterior interosseous artery will be seen piercing the lower end of the interosseous membrane. posterior introcious artery is just passing between the gap between the oblique cord and introcious membrane. Anterior interosseous artery in the lower part, it will actually go through the aperture through the interosseous membrane itself and will be running backward then. Why it is important to note this, guys? Because when you think about the posterior compartment of forearm and the wrist region, we obviously think of that there should be a posterior interosseous nerve and posterior interosseous artery. Well, that is not true once you reach the level of extensor retinaculum. At the level of extensor retinaculum, the nerve running on the posterior side is posterior interosseous nerve, no problem. But the artery at this point will be anterior interosseous artery, because anterior interosseous artery pierces the interosseous membrane, reaches backward, and then descends in one of the compartment of extensor retinaculum, the fourth compartment actually. So when you will talk about the extensor retinaculum, don't get confused. In fourth compartment of extensor retinaculum, the nerve will be posterior interosseous nerve, but artery is anterior interosseous artery. You know the reason why, because it went through this aperture in the interosseous membrane and then runs downward through the extensor retinaculum. Another important osteological feature that you should know here on the ventral aspect of this radius is that there is a line, if you can appreciate there, guys. Let me just darken it up. This line is called as an anterior oblique line. What is the importance? I will discuss that in a while. This is called as an anterior oblique line. Let me try to show it in here. If you look at this radius bone, now this radius, that's a left radius, guys. On this radius bone, starting just below this radial tuberosity, there is an oblique line which goes like this. That is called as an anterior oblique line. And similarly, we have a line present posteriorly called as a posterior oblique line. And they provide attachment to certain muscles, which we will talk about. Okay. Moving on to the lower part of the radius and ulna, the dominant feature here obviously is this radial tuberosity. That's a radial tuberosity, and this one here is the radial styloid. That's a radial styloid process, and that's the ulnar styloid process. Radial ulnar styloid process. If you look at the lower end of the radius ulna, there is something more to be discussed, especially from the lower end of the radius. When you look at the lower end of the radius from the dorsal aspect, there's another important bony prominence that you should know about. And let me show it to you in this another picture here. Now, guys, look at this. This is a picture in which the forearm is shown pronated. So you can see the radius is overlapping the ulna bone after the pronation has taken place. And by the virtue of that, you can actually appreciate the dorsal aspect of the radius. Now, can you see that? Now, this is the dorsal aspect of the radius you're looking at, where you can again appreciate that line is called as a posterior oblique line. And the most important feature which I wanted to notice is this tubercle, which you can see in the lower part. This tubercle, guys, is called as a dorsal tubercle of Lister. It's L-I-S-T-E-R, dorsal tubercle of Lister. Lister's tubercle. It's a very prominent tubercle which you can even feel at the back of your distal end of the radius, the dorsal tubercle of this Lister. And we have a groove on either side of this dorsal tubercle of Lister. The groove which is seen more laterally placed here, this groove is giving passage to the tendon of extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis. The one which are more laterally placed tendon, that is extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis. And the one which is more medially placed tendon, the passing from this groove which is more medially placed, is the tendon of extensor pollicis longus. Now let me tell you the importance here. Tendon of extensor pollicis longus. We'll be looking at all these muscles in a while. So what is important to note here, that there is a tubercle, there's a very prominent tubercle on the dorsal aspect of distal end of the radius called as a dorsal tubercle of Lister. You can easily palpate the tubercle also. And lateral to the tubercle, we have a tendon of ECRL and ECRB. And medial to that, we have a tendon of EPL, extensor pollicis longus. So basically, these are the muscles which are present in the second and the third compartment of extensor retinaculum. These are the tendons present in the second compartment of extensor retinaculum, and extensor pollicis longus is present in the third compartment of extensor retinaculum. So dorsal tubercle of Lister is separating these two tendons of these two separate compartments, second and third compartment. They again can ask you the question like this, that which two compartment tendons are separated by the dorsal tubercle of Lister. And especially it holds a very important role for this EPL tendon, for the extensor pollicis longus tendon. And I wanted to understand this. See, guys, the muscle is named as extensor pollicis longus because the origin of this muscle is actually not from the radius, it is from the ulna. See, if you look at the thumb obviously is in the line with the radius here. So if any muscle is coming for the extension of thumb from the radius and one muscle is coming for the extension of thumb from the ulna, which muscle is supposed to be longer? We have one muscle coming from the radius and one coming from ulna. So obviously the muscle which is coming from the ulna is the muscle which is longer. And that is why extensor pollicis longus muscle, instead of taking origin from the radius, it takes origin from the ulna. But when this extensor pollicis longus tendon goes down, it suddenly has to turn toward the thumb. And that's where this dorsal tubercle of Lister plays a role, because it acts as an anatomical pulley which allows this mechanical transmission of the force in the direction of the thumb. So this dorsal tubercle of Lister is basically, it acts as an anatomical pulley. It acts as an anatomical pulley for the tendon of extensor pollicis longus, because EPL originates from the ulna, but it has to go toward the thumb. So it needs to take a turn from some point, and that turn is provided, or that pulley is provided by this dorsal tubercle of Lister. Another important osteological feature, as I said, we just have to look at the important features, not everything about the radius and ulna. Another important feature that you need to know, guys, when you look at the inferior aspect, when you look at the radius and ulna from the inferior aspect. Now look at this. That's, once again, I'm showing you this left radius. And if you look at the inferior aspect, I hope you can appreciate in the camera that the lateral part is more triangular here and the medial part is more quadrangular. If you can see that, lateral part is triangular and medial part is quadrangular. So when you see it from the inferior aspect, this radius will look something like this. And let us say this here will be the ulna. That's a radius and that's ulna, and this is the inferior aspect we're looking at. Now this triangular facet which is present on the inferior aspect of the radius is for the articulation to the scaphoid bone. This quadrangular facet which is present more medially is for the next lunate bone. But in the formation of the wrist joint, ulna directly is not participating in it, because there is an articular disc, there is a fibrocartilage which is present in this region. There is an articular disc which is present in this region. I'll show it to you in the picture also. Articular disc. This articular disc is also called as a TFCC. What TFCC stands for? It's a triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. In the books of biomechanics, they usually call it TFCC. It's a triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. We all know that articular disc anyways is a fibrocartilage. So it's triangular in shape actually. So we call it triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. So in the formation of this wrist joint, there is a role of the radius bone, which is having a facet for the scaphoid, facet for the lunate. And then we have this articular disc or TFCC, the triangular fibrocartilaginous complex. And let me show you another picture to make you understand that. Look at this, guys. So it's a section, it's a coronal section through the wrist joint. You can see the wrist joint, the proximal, it is formed by the radius here. So which is having attachment to the scaphoid bone, right? That's a attachment to the scaphoid bone. So we have a, and then also to the lunate. But what you can see on this side, we have this TFCC or articular disc. So ulna directly is not participating in the formation of the wrist joint. So it's radius and triangular fibrocartilaginous complex in the proximal part. In the distal part, it's scaphoid, it is lunate. And the important thing is triquetrum is participating in the formation of the wrist joint only in the ulnar deviation. When ulna deviate your wrist, then only the triquetral bone actually comes in contact with the triangular fibrocartilaginous complex or articular disc, and you can consider it as a part of the wrist joint. Otherwise, wrist joint is more about the radiocarpal joint. It's the radius bone, it's a scaphoid and lunate with a contribution from the articular disc. Ulna has no role to play in the formation of the wrist joint. Okay, now Now this is about the major osteological features, guys. I mean, not the attachment. So just two, three things I want to have a quick recap on that. So one, that we saw that radial head is bounded by this ligament called as an annular ligament. There's a process called as a radial styloid process, which is for the insertion of biceps brachii tendon. And ulnar tuberosity is for the insertion of brachialis muscle. Triceps will be inserted on the posterior side. We will see that. The two important thing to be noted from here, one is interosseous membrane, which in the lower part is having aperture for anterior interosseous artery. And in the upper part, we have a gap between the oblique cord and interosseous membrane for the passage of posterior interosseous artery. No role of nerve here. It's the artery we are talking about. So artery going through that gap, and anterior interosseous artery is passing through the gap in the interosseous membrane in the lower part. And oblique cord itself is the remnant of flexor pollicis longus. Now let's come to the muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm and also at the back of forearm. Now I'll be using some pictures, guys. See, what I believe that first you should have an orientation about that, what are the muscles present in the anterior and posterior compartment, how many groups they are arranged in, and then only you can make out that what should be their attachment and origin. Because just simply mugging up the name of the muscles in the compartment of forearm is not helpful. Look at the name of that muscle, and that will give you an idea about that, where it is coming from and especially where it is inserted, which will help you in also counseling their action as well. The muscles in the anterior compartment of forearm, they are basically present in three groups. Some books say two groups, we can say three groups. So we have a most superficial group, then we have an intermediate group, and then we have a deep group. So I'll go with that only. So we have three groups basically: superficial, intermediate, and deep group. The most superficial muscles, or the superficial group muscles, will take origin from common flexor origin, and needless to say, common flexor origin is a medial epicondyle. Now guys, obviously it will be the medial, the lower end of the humerus here. So if this is a lateral epicondyle, and so clearly this one is the medial epicondyle. And we know that medial epicondyle is the common flexor origin. It's not that all the flexors are originating from here, but majority of, and especially the superficial flexors, will be originating from here, but not all of them. Okay, now what are the muscles present in this region? We have a muscle called as a pronator teres. First muscle is pronator teres. Although the origin of pronator teres, there are two heads of pronator teres, and none of them is coming from medial epicondyle. The humeral head of pronator teres comes from above the medial epicondyle, from medial supracondylar ridge. So like there is a medial supracondylar ridge, that's how the pronator teres will come down, and it will be inserted to the lateral side of the shaft of the radius. This muscle is pronator teres. It's really helpful, guys, first to understand these muscles in a schematic picture, and then we can anticipate how these muscles will look like in the atlas and the cadaveric pictures as well. Now there's another head of pronator teres. I'm not drawing that. I'll show it to you in one of the image. That is called as the ulnar head, which is a deep head actually, ulnar head. This is the humeral head, which is not coming from medial epicondyle. It is originating just above the medial epicondyle from medial supracondylar ridge. And then from the medial epicondyle itself, from the common flexor origin, we have these three muscles to be appreciated. One is called as a flexor carpi radialis. I'll take them one by one. Now flexor carpi radialis. Now what you'll see, this muscle, this FCR, flexor carpi radialis muscle, first of all, the muscle is running toward the radial side and then reaching the carpal bone, even going beyond the carpal bone. This flexor carpi radialis, in the lower part, what you will see, it is inserted to the base of second and third metacarpal. See, this will help you remember some extensor origin attachment as well. Base of second and third metacarpal, base of second and third metacarpal. Because when you look at the antagonistic muscle, when you see the muscle called as extensor carpi radialis, there are two extensor carpi radialis, and they will also be attached to the base of second and third metacarpal. The only difference is they are attached on the anterior surface, and they will be attached on the posterior surface. So whether it is a flexor compartment or extensor compartment, there are some common features we need to understand in the attachment of these respective muscles. So muscle is what? Flexor carpi radialis, origin from the common flexor origin, medial epicondyle, and it is seen to be attached to to the base of second and third metacarpal. Okay, now the next muscle, guys, you will see in this here is muscle called as a palmaris longus muscle. And this palmaris longus muscle will actually go, this muscle here is the palmaris longus. It's very frequently absent also. And this palmaris longus muscle in the lower part is seen, it is attached to the superficial part of the flexor retinaculum. It is attached to the superficial part of the flexor retinaculum. The point is, when you see this tendon of the palmaris longus attached to the superficial part of flexor retinaculum, beyond the flexor retinaculum, you will see extension of this muscle or extension of this tendon, which is called as the palmar aponeurosis. So this again could be a question here, that palmar aponeurosis is considered to be the extension of which muscle? It is the palmaris longus, the tendon of palmaris longus, which is attached to the flexor retinaculum. And from the flexor retinaculum, this triangular aponeurosis will be seen running toward the head of the metacarpal, that is the palmar aponeurosis, which is protecting the nerves and vessels in the hand. And then comes another interesting muscle, which is present again coming from the medial epicondyle. This is called as a flexor carpi ulnaris. Now, the reason I'm saying it's an interesting muscle, because guys, flexor carpi ulnaris muscle, first of all, in the lower part, it is holding one sesamoid bone in its tendon, and that is pisiform. So that again is a question here. Pisiform, we all know, is a sesamoid bone, and this sesamoid bone develops in the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. It develops in the tendon of flexor carpi ulnaris. Now, what is the bone distal to the pisiform? The more distal to pisiform is a hamate, and more distal to hamate is a base of, obviously, fifth metacarpal. That is why the flexor carpi ulnaris in the more distal part will be attached to the hook of hamate and also to the base of fifth metacarpal. It is attached to the hook of hamate bone. It is attached to the hook of hamate and the base of fifth metacarpal. I'm very interested in telling you about this attachment on the base of metacarpals, because these muscles, they are not ending at the carpal bones. Although the name says flexor carpi radialis, but it's not, it is inserted to the carpal itself. They are going to the metacarpals, they are going to the base of the metacarpal. The muscle on the lateral side, flexor carpi radialis to the base of second and third metacarpal. Flexor carpi ulnaris, it is extending all the way to the base of fifth metacarpal. So they are basically the major flexor at the wrist joint only, having the attachment to the base of these respective metacarpals. So these are the superficial muscles. I'll show you all these muscles in the atlas image also. I want you to have an orientation first for that. So pronated teres, flexor carpi radialis, palmaris longus, flexor carpi ulnaris. Now let me move on to the next group, that is intermediate group. Some books say it's the intermediate group of muscle, or some simply call it the superficial muscle only, because the name is flexor digitorum superficialis. And it's a very interesting muscle to understand first. Guys, the muscle that we're talking about right now here is the flexor digitorum superficialis. I will be showing you all these muscles in the atlas image. Just bear with me. Here is the, once again, the medial epicondyle. Now, once again, there are two origins for this flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. One head is the humeral head, which is coming from medial epicondyle only. And there is a radial head, which is coming from the anterior oblique line. Remember that line that we said on the radius? So one head will be coming from anterior oblique line. So let's say one head is coming from this anterior oblique line from the radius, and one is coming from this medial epicondyle. And between these two heads, there is an arch which is present here, like this. And then this muscle will be seen going downward like this in the anterior compartment of forearm. And obviously, we'll be dividing into four tendons. First of all, look at the origin. Origin is from where? It is from the medial epicondyle. That is what head? That is the humeral head, the common flexor origin. And then the other head, which is the radial head, is coming from the anterior oblique line. Anterior oblique line. So that's the, and we got an arch in between. So there's an importance of this arch. I'll show it to you. So there's a tendinous arch which is formed here. And what is to be noted, guys, when you look at the distal part of this muscle, when you see that the tendons which are reaching here, these tendons will split in two parts at the level of proximal phalanx. They split at the level of proximal phalanx, but they are attached to the sides of the middle phalanx. Something like this. They will attach to the sides of the middle phalanx in this manner. And why they're attached to the sides of the middle phalanx? So that they can provide a passage or gap in between, and that gap will allow the tendon of flexor digitorum profundus tendons to go through them. This muscle is superficialis. The muscle which is more deep is a flexor digitorum profundus. Profundus tendons need to go to the distal phalanx. Now, how will you reach the distal phalanx? Only when flexor digitorum superficialis tendon provide the space for it. And that space is provided by the splitting of these tendons. These tendons split. They provide the space in between, and then we have a flexor digitorum profundus tendon which will be coming out between these and will reaching the distal phalanx like this. So that's how, why we have such an arrangement here. That, and remember one thing, I repeat again, that these tendons, they split at the level of proximal phalanx, but they're attached to the side of middle phalanx. They're attached to the side of middle phalanx. So that's what muscle? That is a flexor digitorum superficialis. Okay. Coming to the deepest part, guys, coming to the deep group is having main three muscles here. One is called as a flexor pollicis longus, one is flexor digitorum profundus, and pronator quadratus. I'm again using a schematic picture, and then I'll show you in the atlas image. So what do you see here? The deep muscle, one is called as flexor pollicis longus. The name is flexor pollicis longus. Now, obviously, guys, the word pollicis is for the thumb, and thumb is toward the lateral side. And the bone toward the lateral side is radius. So the muscle which is taking origin mainly from the anterior surface of radius, the lateral muscle from the lateral bone, below oblique line we already saw is occupied. Below oblique line, majority of the anterior surface of radius is occupied by the origin of flexor pollicis longus, and its a longus muscle will be seen reaching the distal phalanx of the thumb like this. Similarly, flexor digitorum profundus, FDP, flexor digitorum profundus. Now, digitorum, digits more toward the medial side. So the muscle which is taking origin predominantly from the anterior surface of ulna and interosseous membrane also. This big muscle is a flexor digitorum profundus, which is dividing into four tendons. And you already know that those four tendons are reaching the distal phalanx. And you know already how they reach the distal phalanx? By passing through the gap between the flexor digitorum superficialis. This is a flexor digitorum profundus. It's easy, guys. It's not difficult. It's just that the deep muscles, the muscle for the thumb is toward the lateral side. So coming from lateral bone, from the radius, from the anterior surface of radius. Muscle toward the medial side is for the digits. Flexor digitorum profundus coming from anterior surface of the ulna. Majority of the anterior surface of the ulna. And obviously from the adjoining interosseous membrane. And because these are the deep muscles, these are the muscles which can produce the flexion at the distal phalanges or the distal interphalangeal joint. So they have to go to the distal phalanx here. If somebody asks you what is the function of flexor digitorum superficialis, so that muscle is producing the flexion at proximal interphalangeal joint. But flexor digitorum profundus, because it is reaching the distal phalanx, so their function is to produce the flexion at distal interphalangeal joint. And then there is a muscle called as a pronator quadratus muscle, which is even deeper. The deepest muscle, if I would say here, is a pronator quadratus muscle, which is actually present something like this, from the anterior surface of radius to the anterior surface of the ulna. Just trying to show it here. This muscle, which is more deeper, is the pronator quadratus muscle here. The three deep muscle of anterior compartment of forearm: flexor pollicis longus, flexor digitorum profundus, and pronator quadratus coming from the anterior surface of ulna to the anterior surface of radius, obviously helping in the pronator. And that's the deepest muscle. If somebody asks you what is the deepest muscle of anterior compartment of forearm, it surely is the pronator quadratus. If you understood these attachments on these bones, so let's try to look at these muscles on the atlas image, and this will make you understand their attachment even better. So there we go, guys. Like, look at this. Here's the first picture which is showing you three muscles. I hope by looking at their muscle belly, their origin, and where they are inserting, you can make out what muscle are these. So this muscle clearly is coming from the medial epicondyle. That's a common flexor origin. Look at the muscle running toward the lateral side and you will see it is inserted to the base of the second and third metacarpal. Can you see it below? It is attached to the base of second and third metacarpal. So this muscle clearly is the flexor carpi radialis. The next muscle here, which is shown here, is the palmaris longus. I hope you can appreciate in the lower part, they've shown palmaris longus tendon is cut because it is attached to the flexor retinaculum, which is not shown here. And then it will expand further as the palmar aponeurosis. And the most medial one, that is a flexor carpi ulnaris. Look below here, again flexor carpi ulnaris is having this pisiform bone which is developing in the tendon of this. It is having attachment to this hamate, to the hook of hamate. And if you look carefully, it is also having attachment to the base of fifth metacarpal. Let me try to enlarge this. Look at that. Can you see that? It is enclosing the pisiform, that is enclosed basically. And then it is having attachment to the hamate bone. There is a ligament also called as a pisohamate ligament. So it is attached to that ligament as well and to the base of the fifth metacarpal. The superficial muscle, right? Pronator teres is not shown here. If pronator teres would be here, it is running something in this manner. Okay. The next one, just by the look of it, you can easily identify the muscle. Can you appreciate that arch over there? This is a humero-ulnar head. And this is the radial head coming from the oblique line. And this arch I was talking about, which is an arch present in the FDS muscle, flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. And see, what's the importance of this arch, guys? This arch provided the passage of the nerve and vessel to go deep here. What you will see from the cubital fossa, median nerve and ulnar artery, they have to go deep. Radial artery is superficial. Radial artery is just running deep to brachioradialis muscle. So when the radial artery crosses the cubital fossa, it just has to go deep to the brachioradialis, no big deal. But ulnar artery and median nerve, they need to pass deep. They have to go deep here. So that is this arch is the one which will provide the passage to the median nerve and also provide the passage to the ulnar artery to go deep to this muscle. And then they will be running between the FDS and FDP, between flexor digitorum superficialis and flexor digitorum profundus. The nerve will be the median nerve and the artery here will be the ulnar artery. After that, ulnar artery will give off anterior introitus and posterior introitus, everything. But this arch is the one which provides this median nerve and ulnar artery to pass deep to this muscle. If there is no gap, there is no arch in this region, then how this nerve and artery will go deep to FDS? And to look at the distal attachment here, what I told you that in the distal part, if you trace these tendons, can you see these tendons are splitting and attaching at the middle phalanx and providing the passage for the FDP, flexor digitorum profundus tendon, to reach the base of distal phalanx. That's about FDS, flexor digitorum superficialis, the intermediate group. And finally, the deep group, guys, the deep group. There we go. Three muscles in there. I can see only two now. This muscle, which is predominantly originating from the anterior surface of radius, that is flexor pollicis longus. This one here is the flexor digitorum profundus, and even deep to them would be the pronator quadratus, not shown here. Flexor pollicis longus, if you look, the tendon is going to the base of distal phalanx, and even flexor digitorum profundus tendons are reaching the base of the distal phalanx of the respective digits here. But remember that FPL is more toward the lateral side, originating from the anterior surface of radius and interosseous membrane. Flexor digitorum profundus is originating from anterior surface of the ulna and adjoining interosseous membrane. So that's how the muscles of the anterior compartment of forearm are present. And before I go to the posterior compartment, see, let me just feed in one thing in your brain, that every time you look at a muscle which has to go more distal, or if a muscle is the muscle which has to go more distal, it usually is present more superficial. Like if you look at a muscle, we call it flexor carpi radialis muscle. We have flexor digitorum superficialis muscle. All these muscles are superficial muscles, right? And these muscles are present superficially. The muscle which are present deep to them, they obviously will have a lower attachment. Medial epicondyle was a common flexor origin, isn't it? And it is giving origin to all superficial flexors. Superficial flexors are having a higher origin because they are superficially placed. If a muscle is placed deep to them, like FDS, FDP, FPL, so they obviously will have the origin or their attachment below the common flexor region. So if just the picture of the radius, ulna and humerus is shown to you, so it's quite obvious that the humerus will be giving origin to the superficial flexors because they are present higher and above and they have to go distally. And that muscle which are present deep, flexor digitorum profundus, superficialis, flexor pollicis longus, will have attachment or origin somewhere below the epicondyle from the radius and ulna, right? Deeper the muscle you will see, and you will, more deep muscle will have a more inferior attachment. What is the deepest muscle of anterior compartment of forearm? Pronator quadratus. And look at where it is. It is in the distal part of the forearm here. What are the most superficial muscle of anterior compartment of forearm? That is palmaris longus. It is coming from where? Medial epicondyle here. So, you know, these kind of understanding about the muscles in the forearm will always help you to understand the sections also. I will further upcoming discussions, I will be talking about the transverse sections as well. So as of now, let's move on with our topic here. Okay, now we're coming to the back of the forearm. We'll go the same way. Let us understand the muscles first. What are the muscles in the superficial compartment, deep compartment, and then how will you identify them? Okay. Extensor muscles, the common extensor origin, guys, is obviously the lateral epicondyle. So let us say this here is a medial and that's a back here, it's a lateral epicondyle. So and obviously lateral epicondyle is the highest point from where the we have few muscles even higher to that, but majority of the superficial extensors of the back of forearm will come from lateral epicondyle, and that is why these muscles are in the superficial compartment. The deeper muscles, as I said, the deep muscles in the back of forearm will be having attachment not as high as from the lateral epicondyle. They will be originating somewhere from the radius and ulna only. We'll show it to you. Okay. Now, what are the muscles, guys? First, let me start with this. Obviously, it is the ulnar side here. If I just write U here, that is the ulnar side. And this is the radial side. There is a muscle that you will see originating from the posterior surface of lateral epicondyle, not the common extensor origin. It's a posterior surface of lateral epicondyle and will be seen inserted on the posterior surface of upper part of olecranon process. That muscle is anconeus muscle. One of the muscles supplied by the radial nerve only, the anconeus. Anconeus muscle is present, is originating from posterior surface of lateral epicondyle, and then you will see it is inserted to the posterior surface of olecranon process, upper part basically. Now guys, the muscle that you will see coming from this the common extensor origin, the lateral epicondyle, and look at this muscle which is running very much toward the lateral side going down. Let me tell you what is that. And there's another muscle which is coming from above the lateral epicondyle, from the lateral supracondylar ridge, obviously will be more superficial or more lateral and also coming down like this. This one is going to the second and this one is going to the third metacarpal. The muscle which is outermost muscle here, apart from brachioradialis, this is ECRL, extensor carpi radialis longus, and this is extensor carpi radialis brevis. Guys, extensor carpi radialis longus, which is more laterally placed, is going to the base of second metacarpal, and ECRB is going to the base of the third metacarpal. Let me correlate again. ECRL to the base of second metacarpal, ECRB to the base of third metacarpal. If you remember, when we said flexor carpi radialis, it was also attached, that was a single muscle only, but the tendon was attached to the base of second and third metacarpal on the volar aspect. This time we are looking at a dorsal aspect. So again, ECRL and ECRB are attached to the base of second and third metacarpal respectively to their base, which tells me that ECRL and ECRB in comparison to flexor carpi radialis, these are the kind of muscle which are antagonistic as well as synergistic. So when you have to do the radial deviation, that's a radial deviation. So radial deviation will be done by the flexor carpi radialis as well as the extensor carpi radialis longus and brevis both. So they are synergistic. But because one is the muscle of anterior compartment and one is a muscle of posterior compartment, so obviously one is for the palmar flexion and one is for dorsiflexion. And that's why they're antagonistic muscle as well. So there are certain muscle which acts as synergist also and antagonist also. And you usually find these muscles toward the sides here, like toward the ulnar side or toward the radial side. I repeat again, ECRL, ECRB in comparison to flexor carpi radialis, which are the muscles of opposite compartment, are definitely antagonistic. One is a flexor, one is extensor of the wrist. But they all together will do the radial deviation, so they are synergist also in the radial deviation. Okay, so we are talking about the superficial muscles here. We are looking at the superficial muscles. Okay, again, coming from the same lateral epicondyle, there's another muscle, guys, that you will see, that is an extensor digitorum muscle, and obviously extensor digitorum muscle will be divided into, the tendons are divided into these digits, the medial four fingers. I'm just writing ED here, that is extensor digitorum. We do not have extensor digitorum superficialis or profundus. Like in the flexor compartment, there was a superficialis and profundus. So the muscle are attached to the middle phalanx, and then one are attached to distal phalanx. In this case, we have only one muscle called as extensor digitorum. So tendons of extensor digitorum in the distal part are attached both to the proximal phalanx, both to the middle phalanx as well as distal phalanx. You're getting my point? We do not have superficialis or deep for extensor digitorum, unlike in the flexor compartment. We just have one muscle called as extensor digitorum. So this one muscle only have to extend the digits here. So the extensor digitorum tendon are not only attached to the distal phalanx, they are also attached to the middle phalanx, and that's why they are a very strong extensor at both the interphalangeal joint, at the proximal also as well as at the distal also. So their tendon, extensor digitorum tendon, they're attached to the middle and the distal phalanx. Yet another muscle you will see, guys, the muscle that you will see, which is again coming from the same lateral epicondyle, will be going downward, and then you will see this muscle is going to the little finger. So we have an additional tendon, we have an additional muscle or additional tendon for the digiti minimi. This is the extensor digiti minimi. Extensor digiti minimi. The muscle is extensor digiti minimi. So little finger is having one extensor digitorum tendon, and it is having a special muscle for it called as extensor digiti minimi. Same common extensor origin is the origin point, and insertion is just like the extensor digitorum itself. And finally, another important and interesting muscle here, that is extensor carpi ulnaris. So obviously the muscle coming from the same common extensor origin, going more toward the ulnar side, and then now according to you guys, it should attach to which metacarpal? Just like flexor carpi ulnaris, it is also attached to the base of dorsal aspect of fifth metacarpal. This muscle is what? This is the extensor carpi ulnaris. And it is not easy to differentiate between the extensor carpi ulnaris and flexor carpi ulnaris. If it is a cadaveric view of this medial side of the forearm, it is definitely not easy to differentiate these two muscles. It looks like a single muscle only when you see on this side here. But yes, when you trace the tendon in the distal part, obviously you will see one tendon is in the anterior compartment, one is in the posterior compartment, and both are going and ultimately attached to the base of fifth metacarpal only, one to the dorsal aspect, which is extensor, and one to the palmar aspect, which is flexor. So once again, if you compare the extensor carpi ulnaris with flexor carpi ulnaris muscle of the anterior compartment, these are antagonistic as well as synergist muscle. They're antagonistic again in palmar flexion and dorsiflexion, and they are synergist in the ulnar deviation. This is the superficial group that we're looking at. Even when you look at the atlas image or a cadaveric picture of the back of the forearm, it is definitely not easy to identify these muscles in the proximal part. You can differentiate these muscles by looking at the tendon, that where they're going. So it's important to understand that how the tendons are running and where, which finger they're supposed to go in. Now, apart from this, we have some deep muscles also. Let us discuss those important four deep muscles here. There are four major deep muscles in the lower part, and then I'll show you the images in the atlas. Okay, so let me use this picture here to show the deep muscle. Guys, first of all, the deep muscle that we're talking about, majority of the deep muscle, they're running toward the thumb. Not all of them, but majority of the deep muscle are running toward the thumb. And essentially every deep muscle is running toward the lateral side. Okay, Now just understand this attachment here. This bone obviously is the ulna, and this here is the radius. Now what you'll see that there is a muscle which will be originating from both radius and ulna, and also from the introcious membrane. I want you to understand these muscles, because if it is a picture given from the dorsal aspect of the forearm, you have to keep this point in mind. You will see a muscle originating from the posterior surface of radius and ulna both. This is obviously the ulna here, and that is radius. And then what you will see that this muscle, after originating from here, is going toward the lateral side and into the thumb. This muscle is the abductor pollicis longus. There are a few important things to understand here. Abductor pollicis longus, where it is reaching, I'll tell you. Just mark it here. Then what you'll see below, we have two muscles. One is called as extensor pollicis longus, and one is extensor pollicis brevis. I told you earlier also, guys, longus muscle is the longest here for the reason because it has to come from the bone which is away from the thumb. The bone which is close to the thumb here is obviously radius, and the bone away from the thumb is ulna. So the muscle that you will see which is coming from the posterior surface of the radius and then running along with the same tendon and reaching the proximal phalanx, this is the tendon of extensor pollicis brevis. Why brevis? Because the radius bone is close. Radius is close to the to the thumb, and anyways the muscle is going only to the proximal phalanx. Whereas the longest muscle will be originating from the posterior surface of ulna and corresponding interosseous membrane. So obviously this muscle is coming from a bit far off, and when you see this muscle coming down, it will be coming like this. And I hope you remember, we said dorsal tubercle of Lister. Dorsal tubercle of Lister is the one which will provide the pulley, anatomical pulley for that. So this muscle will be coming down like this and then turning from the dorsal tubercle of Lister to reach the distal phalanx. What muscle is that? This is extensor pollicis longus. And I hope you all know that between this EPL and EPB, in this part we have anatomical snuff box. So anatomical snuff box, which is present between the EPB tendon, extensor pollicis brevis tendon, which is more lateral, and extensor pollicis longus tendon, which is more medial. And why they are medial and lateral, I already told you. The bone which is closer will have a short muscle coming from it. The bone which is further will have a long muscle, the longest muscle coming from it. And the space between them is the snuff box here. Okay. And there's another muscle which is originating even further below. And that muscle is an additional tendon for the index finger. Just remember the name. This muscle is called as extensor indicis. I'm writing EI, that is extensor indicis. So when you look at those fingers, we have an extensor digitorum tendon which is going to all four digits, but your little finger and your index finger are having additional tendon in them. There was an extensor digiti minimi tendon, additional, and there is an extensor indicis tendon which is there in this index finger here. So these are the deep muscles, guys. These are deep muscle you're looking at. One is abductor pollicis longus, the most lateral one here, along with and having a highest origin on the posterior surface of the radius ulna both, an introsseous membrane. Pollicis brevis from the radius close to the thumb. Pollicis longus from the ulna away from the thumb. And then even below that we have an extensor indicis, which is for the index finger, extension of the index finger here. Now time to look at these muscles in the atlas image, and that will probably make more sense. There we go. Look at this. Now it's up to you to identify these muscles, guys. I hope you can. This muscle, look at this, coming from the posterior surface of the lateral epicondyle and going to the posterior surface of the olecranon process. This is anconeus muscle. I'm just writing anconeus. Then the highest muscle that you're looking at is a brachioradialis. I'm not talking about brachioradialis here, but coming from the lateral supracondylar ridge, this is ECRL. And you can see this muscle is running laterally. Look at, if you trace downward here and going below to the base of second metacarpal. Just next muscle, that is ECRB, extensor carpi radialis brevis. You trace the tendon downward and you will see it is attached to the base of third metacarpal. Agreed? Then coming from the common extensor origin, if I go with that one by one, this is the tendon of extensor digitorum. Once again, trace the extensor digitorum tendon below. These are the 1, 2, 3, 4 tendons you can see below. And there's an additional muscle here that is extensor digiti minimi, which is showing you an additional tendon going toward the little finger. Can you see that? There are two tendons that you see in the dorsal aspect of the little finger. One is for extensor digiti minimi and one for the extensor digitorum. And finally, extensor carpi ulnaris. Extensor carpi ulnaris coming again from the common extensor origin. And look at that. Below, you already know that it has to insert to the base of the fifth metacarpal. The base of fifth metacarpal. What about deep muscle? The deeper muscles. Now, before I show you the picture of deep muscles, guys, the deep muscle will come out like this and they will be overlapping ECRL and ECRB. Whatever deep muscle we discussed, especially the deep muscle forming the boundary of the snuff box, they're actually overlapping the ECRL and ECRB tendon. And that's why the ECRL and ECRB tendons are present in the floor of the anatomical snuff box. ECRL and ECRB tendon are present in the floor of the anatomical snuff box. So let me show you this one more picture for you. And there we have it. Look at that. Look at this, guys. What muscle would this be? If you trace that muscle, this muscle is having a highest in the deeper compartment, having high origin is the abductor pollicis longus, and this abductor pollicis longus is reaching till the metacarpal. See, for the abduction of thumb, it doesn't matter you are going to the phalanges or you're going to the metacarpal, because when you abduct the metacarpal, automatically the thumb will get abducted here. In the extension of the thumb, it matters, or in the flexion of the thumb, it matters whether the muscle is going or inserting to the proximal or to the distal phalanx. In the abduction, it doesn't matter, because once you abduct the metacarpal, the thumb automatically will also get abducted along with it. What is the muscle which is coming from the posterior surface of the radius? This is extensor pollicis brevis. What is the muscle coming from the posterior surface of the ulna? That was extensor pollicis longus. And I hope you can see that space over there which I'm marking here. That is the anatomical snuff box. And finally, this tendon we talked about, which is coming from the posterior surface of ulna only and going to the index finger, to the distal phalanx of the index finger, that is extensor indicis. These are the deep muscles which are present in the back of forearm. The deep muscles present in the back of forearm. You need to have the holistic approach to all these muscles. You know, as I said, understanding these, a detailed attachment is not very much needed, that whether it is to introitus membrane or not, or it is to exactly which phalanx. But if you understand that how these muscles are arranged and which metacarpal or which phalanges they are reaching, you will definitely find that this will also assist you in understanding so many anomalies in the orthopedics as well. Certain fractures, which muscles are involved, which will not be involved, which I'm going to take in the next session, guys. So in the third session, which we'll have next week, we'll be talking about the muscles of the hand. And we'll also see the implication of all these muscles that we discussed, right from the shoulder region till the hand here. Some clinical implication also. In the meantime, I would request you that I have a video on the YouTube, which is about the cadaveric dissection, cadaveric videos. If you understood these muscles, arrangement of these muscles here in this schematic picture, please go to that YouTube channel of mine and look for those videos. There's an upper limb video in which I have discussed all the cadaveric pictures of the upper limb musculature. And when you look at those muscles after this video, you definitely will have a better understanding of that. Right. So that's all for the day. We'll be meeting you next week. And in that, as I said, we'll be talking about the muscles of the hand, all the intrinsic muscles and their clinical implication of all the muscles of the upper limb as well. Till then, bye-bye.